And this slide summarizes the mode of action of the different direct thrombin inhibitors. Rhizthrombin with the catalytic site and the fibrinogen binding site. Iridine binds to both sites and then has a very efficient neutralization of thrombin activity, which is unable to bind to fibrinogen and to clot it. Bivalirubin still keeps both sites, but with a much smaller size than iridine, about three times smaller than iridine. Irugen is part of bivalirubin, but only for blocking the active site. And argatroban has, so argatroban binds to thrombin and blocks its activity, but not on the active site. So here it is the active site, and here it is the fibrinogen binding domain. So argatroban only blocks the active site, urigen only the fibrinogen binding site, bivalirubin and iridine both sites. Okay, but in any case, you know, direct thrombin inhibitors as argatroban and dabigatran block the thrombin activation site. So I will stop for the first part of my presentation, and then we will continue after the break with the diagnostic assays. If you have short questions at this time, but we will leave after the presentation at least half an hour or more for exchanging ideas and for discussion. So we have basically two major groups of assays for testing heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. The first group concerns platelet activation or platelet aggregation test, which are performed at high or low heparin concentration. And concerning the platelet activation assays, we have platelet aggregation performed at high and low heparin concentration, a variant which was developed by Andreas Grenacher in Germany, which is a heparin-induced platelet activation assay, which can be performed with WASH healthy platelets using a microELISA plate, and the gold standard for platelet activation assay, which is a C14 serotonin release assay, report in 1986 by Sheridan and Kelton from Canada. The second group concerns the different immunoassays, which were developed when PF4 was identified as the major antigen for binding heparin-dependent antibodies. And we can have some variants. The basic original test uses PF4 complex with heparin for capturing heparin-dependent antibodies. And there was a variant developed just after, which used polyvinyl sulfonate for binding to PF4 because there was a patent for the original assay, and it was not possible to use heparin and PF4 for capturing the assays. And now the new assays are evolving to focus more on the IgG isotype, which is the one which shows the higher specificity and sensitivity for clinical hit. There are other immunoassays which have been developed. There is a latex assay using the Pagia technology from Diamet, and it uses a gel with latex particles coated with PF4. I will show the details of the different tests with the next slides. And if antibodies are present, aggregates forms, and the latex cannot enter the gel. And if there is no antibody, latex particles can penetrate the gel, and they are obtained at the bottom of the device. And there was also the PIFA assay, which is an immunofiltration assay using latex particles. So concerning the platelet activity assays, they are summarized on this slide. Normally, the best is to use a heat inactivated serum of plasma coming from the test patient. And it is tested with a platelet, RLC platelets, in presence of a low or high heparin concentration, or in presence of a monoclonal antibody which blocks the Fc gamma R2 activity. And if antibodies, heparin-dependent antibodies, able to activate platelets are present at low heparin concentration, then platelets will be activated. And in the absence and in the presence of high heparin concentration, there will be no activation, which confirms the heparin dependent antibody specificity. And if the Fc gamma R2 receptor is blocked, there's also no activation. So we can have in this case two different controls. All the platelet activation assays use the same assay principle, but the endpoint for evaluating the amount of activated platelets induced by the heparin independent antibodies can be different. We can use ATP and chemiluminescence, the gold standard with C14 serotonin release, and radioactivity measurement. Another essay reported by Lee from the Calton group concerns micro, and from the Varkantin group concerns microparticles measurement by flow cytometry, or the conventional platelet aggregation assay with light transmission. So concerning these platelet activation assays, usually different blood donors need to be tested because all healthy donors are not equivalent between them. And usually four different donors are used, and the assay has to be positive with at least two or better three healthy donors for concluding to a positive platelet activation assay. Concerning the assay performance, it is better to work with washed platelets, which helps to have better performance, higher specificity, and higher sensitivity. And platelets are obtained from blood collected on ACD anticoagulant. They are centrifuged at low speed for preparing the platelet-rich plasma. And then we can recover the platelets by a complementary centrifugation and wash the platelets with a Thiroth buffer containing platelet activation inhibitors. And then finally, the final platelet pellet is resuspended in a Thiroth buffer containing physiological concentrations of calcium at pH 7.4 and without platelet aggregation activation inhibitors, of course, in this case. And then platelets are in a buffer containing all the necessary for allowing the right performance, and these washed platelets can use with one of the different assays available for testing platelet activity. Concerning HIT, the most popular assays are the gold standard for the few laboratories able to run this assay, or platelet activation assay, which is less sensitive. And it is very important to include these controls in order to confirm the heparin-dependent antibody specificity, because many other circumstances can induce platelet activation if these controls are not performed.